Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the City of Brockton's Diversity Commission on this particular day. We welcome all our fellow citizens here. If you have business before this commission, please draw near and you shall be heard. Just so as some for some housekeeping items, Maria gave me this note. Please make sure that your phones have been silenced. In addition to that, this is being recorded. I have authorized the recording based upon my statutory authority. So if you do not want yourself to be recorded, I would strongly suggest that you not say anything. The second piece of this is to please make sure that we remain respectful if you are able to ask questions this evening. At this point, I'm going to ask each commissioner to please identify themselves, starting with Commissioner Miller.
Thank you. My name is Ed Miller. Since the beginning on the commission. Ed Miller, I've been on the since the beginning of the commission, formerly of the Library Commission. Thank you.
Thank you. Deidre Smith, I work at the high school. I'm an English teacher, and I've been on the commission just starting this year.
Jacob Taggart Jr., I'm Vice Chair of the Diversity Commission. Of course, this is my first year.
Maria DeCanto, and I've been on the commission since the beginning. Thanks for you guys coming today.
I am Bishop Tony Branch. I'm Chair of the Diversity Commission.
I'm Edward Downey, retired social worker, past president of NAACP, member of the commission.
Brenda Perez, I'm my first year with the commission.
Adriano Cabral, this is my first appointment for the commission. I'm a mental health practitioner. There is no mic.
So we can project our voices, that would be helpful. Pledge, if you can introduce yourself.
Yes, hi, I am Pledge Marcelin, one of the commissioners.
First item on the agenda is the adoption of prior minutes. Commissioner, have you looked at the prior minutes?
Yes.
Our audience, just to let you know, the prior minutes are typically sent to the commissioners by way of email because of their length. You guys were supposed to print them out?
I looked them out online.
Well, if you've already looked at them,
motion to adopt. Second.
All those in favor by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Next item on the agenda is the invitation of Superintendent Kathleen Smith of the Brockton Public Schools. Prior to the introduction of Kathleen Smith, I just want to ask if she has any staff members that you want to introduce, Superintendent.
First of all, I want to thank you for having me here this evening. It is a pleasure to come before you. I want to thank you for your service because I think each one of us is here for reasons, because we care about the city, we care about our young people, and we want to make sure that they get the best education possible from the best educators and the best school system, and I think we continue to do that. This evening, I do have accompanying me my executive director of our human resource office, Dr. Kathleen Moran, who is a longtime Brockton Public School school teacher.
Dr. Moran, can you stand up, please, for the audience? Thank you.
I don't know the exact number of years, but it's at least 12 years Dr. Moran's been in the system. Also, Elisa Martineau is one of our associate directors, and Elisa and I go way back working together at East Junior High at the time, and Elisa has been here close to 30 years. I also have Michelle Bolton, who is our communications officer in the district, and I believe that is it. I have also, I can see two school committee members that are present, Mr. Thomas Minicello, who is Ward 1 school committee member and vice chair of the school committee, and I saw Lisa Plant, Ward 2, so she's tiny, you've got to kind of look for her down there, Ward 2 school committee member. I also saw Ozzie Jordan, who, again, Ozzie and I have worked together for many years with Community School Advisory Board. He took over when Mike Healy unfortunately passed away just about 2 years ago, I believe. Ozzy came on board and filled that role wonderfully. So I'm pleased to have you here joining us also. I think that's it.
Thank you. Sorry about that.
Are there any members of the Brockton City Council here? Could you please stand, please? So we have Brockton City Councilor Tom
Monahan.
I was about to call him Thomas formally, something else. But we welcome you here, and we were hoping that on the record that there would be much more, many more city councilors here because diversity is a huge issue in the city of Brockton. Well, we have our superintendent. I appreciate that, Commissioner. We're here today because of findings and recommendations that were made by this commission using data from the Brockton School Department. So I'm going to read our findings of facts into the record, and at this point, and at that point, Superintendent Smith will do a presentation. The findings of fact are found on page 3 of your documentation, and I'll read them as follows. Based on baseline data incorporated in these findings, the district struggles with the recruitment and selection of a diverse workforce. The district provided no affirmative action plan, just an affirmative action statement that the district failed to update for 14 years. At minimum, affirmative action planning denotes positive steps taken to increase the representation of women and minority within the district. The district has affirmatively employed women, albeit or primarily white women, but low numbers of minorities. The commission aversed there must be an executive commitment to diversifying the district workforce and that a senior leader must be directly accountable for diversity efforts moving forward. These are the facts. The district population, the city of Brockton, is 95,314 citizens with a racial breakdown of 46.7% white, 31.2% black, 0.4% Native American, 2.3% Asian, 0.1% Native Hawaiian, 6.9% of mixed race, 10% Hispanic. However, the highest concentration, the highest concentration of all positions are to non-minorities. We do not believe that that is an anomaly. Students also fail to see a reflection of themselves in the teaching staff. The district's ratio of minority students is 78.2%, according to the Massachusetts Department of Education. As a result of our findings, we requested that the Brockton Public Schools track all resumes and applications to determine the hiring decisions and outcomes, why an applicant was not chosen. We immediately requested an affirmative marketing of open positions to diversity media. We requested that all positions be captioned, minorities encouraged to apply, and we requested that the Brockton Public Schools conduct a job fair. So let me be absolutely clear, people. This may not be the complete answer, but it's at the beginning of a process. I am a 30-year human resource professional. I've been both at the generous level and at the executive level. And it is my professional opinion that we can do a better job, and that is supported by the data. We now turn this meeting over to Superintendent Kathleen Smith.
Thank you. It's going to be difficult to hold this and talk. First of all, I do have some prepared statements. More importantly, I think this needs to be a conversation. I will acknowledge that we can always do a better job. You know, looking at the commission's finding, this is certainly not something new. I came on as superintendent, was selected in March of 2013, took over in July of 2013, and it has been something I talked about during my interview process. I continue to work with the district proactively. Before I begin, I do want you to know that we started a couple of years ago bringing people together to talk about this issue, college presidents, and I'm talking college presidents from UMass Boston, Bridgewater State, UMass Dartmouth, Massasoit Community College, Stonehill College, where we came together to talk about not only bringing educators and the diversity of our education force, but also the struggles that they were having at the college level, bringing young people to come into the field of education, and I will talk about that.
I also want to stress that this year, after conversations with a number of people, I went before Messiah Baptist Church at an NAACP forum back in August, and one thing was clear was that we needed to bring community members on board to really start to have this dialogue. So before I do begin, I do want to say that we do have our own Brockton Public Schools Diversity Task Force. We've met four times, with a fifth meeting coming up on February 21st. I invite anybody to come to these meetings. There very much has been a lot of dialogue, a lot of work. I'll share our action plan. And I do want to introduce some of the members that are here this evening. One is your own Jacob Tagger, who I did ask for a member from the city's diversity commission to come on to our task force. And also, I have Steve Bernard, the former president of NAACP, just recently actually retired. I know Joe Rucker is here from NAACP, and I believe Leona Martin is also here from the NAACP. I do want to mention, and I'm not sure if I missed anybody, but I do want to mention the others that are on this task force. Brenda Weiss from the Brockton Interfaith Community, Mozart St. Cyr, a community member, Cassie Sermon, a community member, Darren Duarte from the office of Mayor Bill Carpenter, and as I mentioned, Dr. Kathleen Moran, our executive director of HR, Elisa Martineau, an associate director, Dr. Margaret Howard, representing the clergy and from Messiah Baptist Church, and also Laurie Silva, who works in our community school office and has been instrumental in a number of these proactive things we've done. So a couple of prepared things I do want to say. I do acknowledge that it is something that we all need to work on, because there's truly nothing better for our students than to see themselves in the adults that they see in their daily lives. And we all know it doesn't matter if it's the doctor we go to, the lawyer that represents us, and certainly more importantly, when you talk about the time we spend with young children, that teacher in the classroom. And it's more than that. And I know tonight we are here to talk about the professionals, but we also have people that make up our school community. We have custodians, we have people that work in the cafeteria, we have monitor teacher assistants who have bachelor's degrees who are looking for avenues to come into teaching. We have paraprofessionals that work in the district. So there are many people that work in our district beyond teachers, and I'll certainly try to talk about all of those levels. And I do think it's important that, and I hope you give me some liberty here, when you talk about breaking barriers, I always look at people, and I'm going to mention Senator Tom Kennedy. Here's a person at 19 years old, suffered an accident in a wheelchair, and I know in front of students that had disabilities, because I taught those very students, it was important for them to see that somebody can succeed, that we don't make excuses. It's important when you look at, and when I ask for the liberty, you know, to have a white woman sit here, it might not seem that it was difficult for me, but in your 240 years of having superintendents in the Brockton Public Schools, I'm the first woman superintendent of this district. And there are many superintendents that are women throughout our state, but I was the first. I'm very proud when I tell that to young women, because I believe that people want to look up to somebody and say, I can be that person. We all know how we felt 8 years ago when President Barack Obama came on board. You know, that was groundbreaking for all of our communities, our nation, and to listen to children and to look into their eyes. So I acknowledge how important it is for our children to see those people that they look up to and think that they can be that particular person. You have Dee Smith sitting here. You have an excellent teacher. I've watched Dee teach. I've watched how she interacts with kids. And I know, Dee, that that makes a difference each and every day for the kids in your classroom. So that being said, we want to be inclusive. And when I look around this room tonight, there are those of you, and I don't want to call you out, my former cheerleader from Brockton High, Dee Bell, Laurie Watson. These are people, when I look at many of you, I've worked with you, I've been in the community with you, and I'm proud of my interactions. You know, I think you would see me as somebody that wants to include people, wants to make people, you know, part of something successful. But I also acknowledge, Bishop Branch, that we have a lot of work to do. And before I leave here tonight, and I'll answer every one of your questions, it is not work that we can do alone. I'm not going to be defensive tonight. I'm not going to make excuses. I am going to talk about what I see, you know, are some of the facts. You mentioned Bishop Branch, and there is certainly information out there that there are challenges in hiring minority teachers to come into our district, and many districts, not just Brockton. There are few minority college graduates choosing to become teachers. There's a very leaky pipeline, a recruiting pipeline. Minority teachers make up 18% of the education workforce, you know, in our country. In Brockton right now, we do have a number of district initiatives to increase minority hires, to bring teachers into the classroom, and increase our administrative minority roles. I talked previously about an administrative internship program that we have. This is a program when you talk about administrators. Many times in Brockton, we have had very good luck of really growing our own administrators. And that clearly is an opportunity after, I believe, 5 years in the district, Dr. Moran. You are able to apply for an administrative internship. It is open to every single teacher we have. We pay particular attention if there are minority teachers who are looking to get into administration because we know that's an area that we need to continue to fill and we have to start somewhere. We will have anywhere from 40 applicants. We interview every one of them. These are applicants in our own district, by the way. We interview every one of those applicants and we make an effort if there are minority candidates. It's actually an opportunity to work with an administrator for about 8 weeks. Many times we put them into the schools, we have them work at central administration, and some of them have not even gone on to get their administrative licensure or certification, but they will say, I enjoyed this, I'm good at it. And we are encouraging continually. You look at some recent hires, you know, Carlton Campbell, for one, is right now our interim assistant principal at West Middle School. And when I go there, I watch the kids. I watch how excited they are for them to look up to, you know, a black man who has quite a presence. And he's great with the kids, and that's important. And that is, again, an opportunity through our administrative internship program. So there are administrators coming on board that are able to go through our very own program. Now, when you ask about looking outside of Brockton, there are few candidates. And some of the struggles that we have is many times when we're looking to recruit, we have what is called school spring. And this is recruitment for people all over the state. It's an online program. It is difficult sometimes when you're putting together resumes, we're looking at qualifications. Many candidates do not select and tell you that they are minority candidates. So for our HR office, they are doing the best job they can to not only look at, when we're talking administrative positions, in-house candidates, but also candidates that we welcome in to look for that highly qualified or best person that we can find for the job. So that's something we've done for years. I myself did the administrative internship program back in 1999. I had just graduated from law school, thought I was going to be leaving to practice law. I did the administrative internship program and decided that that would be my career and I would stay in the school. So this is clearly something that, you know, is open to all of the people in our school district. We recently were awarded a planning grant from the state Department of Elementary and Secondary Education looking at a district pipeline report on developing student-teacher partnership consortiums. Our partnership grant was with Bridgewater State University, and we are working with places like Bridgewater because they are also struggling with people going into education and people that they can actually send our way, and that would be our pipeline. I recently had a conversation with the president of both Bridgewater and Massasoit, and one of the things that was said was last year, there were 18 students from Brockton High School, our Brockton High School, who applied to Bridgewater to get into the education program. And again, there's a lot of competition. And the dean at Bridgewater struggled because what came back for those 18 was, and there were some that certainly were accepted into Bridgewater's program, but they asked them to go to a community college, whether it was their SAT scores, there was something keeping them out of getting into that program. We are now developing a partnership with Bridgewater so a student could be dually enrolled in both colleges, so they can take some courses at Massasoit and at the same time matriculate at Bridgewater. So they're having also an experience at a four-year college. And again, our strongest pipeline, because we can talk all about the national levels and I'll show you, you know, some of the data we have. But the strongest thing that you have here in Brockton, and many of you have heard me talk about this, when I go to the National Honor Society induction program, those students, 200 of them, look like Brockton High. There are 80% minority students there, and your smartest students are part of that elite group. When you go and see the John and Abigail Adams scholarship winners, and you look at, and you'll see the number, you know, 200, and I can't remember the number this year, 260, 270 students that receive this honor when they take the MCAS test. They look like our population at Brockton High School. And the struggle is this, and you need to all join me in this, is students are selecting other fields to go to. I talked to Principal Sharon Walder. We will have discussions about some of our students, the first generation going to college, and they are going to elite schools. They're selecting to be your doctors, your lawyers, your businessmen, and they are not selecting to go into education. And that's something, when I opened school this year with 1,400 teachers, one of the things I talked about was we need to do a better job, and I'll talk about that with our action plan, of making sure that even as teachers, we are talking to our students about the importance of going into our career and encouraging them to do this. We started a few years ago, and you know, the word I want to try to stay away from tonight is budget, because that has been a struggle since, I think I'm the bad luck charm, because it has been since the day I came on board as superintendent.
I'm the bad luck charm.
Well, it has been nothing short of a struggle. And I'll talk about, again, getting back to that, but my first year when we were met with a difficult budget, we were actually able to bring back every one of our present teachers that year, and that was with cutting many other programs. And that would have been in the spring of 14. In the spring of 15, we laid off teachers, and we laid off teachers through every single level. Last year, which would have been the spring of 16, we laid off over 60 teachers, some that are still not back in our workforce. And that presents a struggle. When you are out there competing against, and we'll look at some of those those different districts, when I'm competing against a Boston for the few minority teachers that appear to be out there, Boston pays a little better, they're not that far away, and many times, and I'll bet if you go on the Boston Public School website right now, you will find teaching positions there. If you look at our Brockton Public School website, and I brought all the list, and there are some positions right now, and I'll talk about the positions there. They're positions that have other qualifications, such as teacher of visually impaired. These people could be hired right now. If there's a qualified candidate out there, minority candidate, non-minority, come to our HR office. We'll make sure you have all of your paperwork completed. But that job right now is available. A special education teacher for the emotionally impaired. A kindergarten inclusion teacher, which is a special education position. An SEI teacher, a bilingual teacher for grade 3. A Portuguese teacher for our kindergarten, a bilingual math Cape Verdean teacher for the middle school, a special education life skills teacher at Brockton High School, a technology teacher in graphics for Brockton High, a bilingual biology teacher. So we have a number of positions, and we do not have applicants to fill those positions. And that's something that I think all of us, I had talked this summer when I met with Reverend Walker, that one of the things I wanted to be was invited back to Messiah Baptist Church. I'm going there on the 16th of March because we need help from the community when we start to talk about filling some of these roles. It isn't just our job. It's the families, the moms, the dads, the relatives. If you know a student out there who would love to come into the teaching profession, to be that coach, to be that teacher, you know, the salary is very good. The benefits are very good. And I would say that the culture and climate in our schools and our Brockton Public School family is superb. I've been there for 40 years. So I encourage people to certainly join us in that. I'll tell you, again, in looking at some of my notes here, we have our Grow Your Own program. We have it at the high school. It is strong. At one point, we were cutting clubs at the high school, and that was one club I would not touch. We now have what we call Educators Rising. We've developed curriculum. It's going on at, I think, 4 of our 6 middle schools with hopes of bringing every one of them on board. And this is to encourage not only our students to go into teaching, but also to talk to them about volunteering if they're high school in our elementary and middle, and to have those summer jobs, the few that we seem to have left because of loss of a lot of the grants. But for that opportunity to come in and to say that this is a valuable profession. I will tell you, when you talk about hiring, and people push back and they'll say to me, well, you're talking about a custodian jobs. Our custodian jobs, again, an excellent workforce. You know, they are keeping, you know, aging buildings so that our kids can certainly have the education that we would want from them. And I'm going to take you back to when we were hiring in 2015, because I do believe that in the Brockton Public Schools, we absolutely deserve better than an F when you talk about some of the things that we are able to make a difference. We had 8 custodial positions that were opened, and I think it was during the year 2014 into 15. We had 66 people apply, and that's not unusual. 66 people apply. We interviewed 56 of those 66, and 10 of them were hired. We had 10 open positions. Of the 10, 7 were minority, 4 were females, black females, and 3 were males, 2 black and 1 Asian. We just hired recently 2 school police officers, and that's what I've hired since I've been here. And I'm very pleased to tell you, when you hear me talk about grow your own, the 2 police officers that we hired were hired because, first of all, they had superb credentials, and they were the best possible candidates. They were also graduates of Brockton High School. You know, one is Jamal Johnson. He's a graduate of Brockton High. I believe went to Stonehill College, worked at Bridgewater State University in their police force, and is now proud to be a Brockton School police officer. We have another young woman, I believe, I'm not going to have her name correctly, so I won't say it. She is waiting to get into the police academy on March 1st. She is a Brockton High School graduate. I believe she's Kate Verdian, and she is a graduate of UMass Dartmouth. So when I talk about grow your own, I need you to join me that those are our best candidates. They're comfortable coming here. They know our high school. They know our community. And certainly, as I said, I want you to also understand they were the best candidates for that job. Our outreach to college and career fairs, and I'll let Dr. Moran talk to you at some point if you would like this evening. But there was money put in the budget, and they would go out and do job fairs all over the place, and it got to the point that we didn't have, at one point we were hiring 100 teachers, and they were looking to bring teachers on board to come to Brockton, actively researching and out there. The past couple of years, we haven't gone to job fairs. We struggle when we think of laying off teachers to the tune of 60 last year, I think 45 the year before. So to bring people on board, and the other thing that we're struggling with, if you look in the paper at your surrounding communities and look at every one of them, you'll look at Abington Public Schools, and they will already have their budget set for next year with an increase of like 3.1%. That's pretty much an average. Every one of your surrounding towns has completed their budget. They're looking at their plans for next year for hiring. In the Brockton Public Schools, along with the city of Brockton, and you have Councilor Monahan here that will tell you, we finish our budget. Usually, I'm lucky if it's finished by July 1st. I'm lucky if the state last year finished by August 1st. That's when we were trying to bring teachers back. We didn't have a new teacher orientation this year because we didn't get to hire teachers. Now, that doesn't mean that if there are some positions, and it's usually a special education position, some of the positions I just mentioned, then yes, we are actively recruiting and trying to hire. But we do not have a solid budget set to bring people on board when we're competing with people around us. And unfortunately for us, we just got word of our budget, and it's not that we're not gonna fight, we're gonna advocate. I was with Jay Condon today. We've been meeting with the school committee. We had a 7-hour retreat 2 Saturdays ago, and we will continue to advocate and look for the best possible budget we can have so we're able to continue to move our district forward. We are planning, and Bishop Branch, you mentioned a job fair. And you know what, sometimes it's one of those things that it's right in front of you, and you probably should have noticed that. So we're looking to bring, and I will share with you afterwards, it is here, from our diversity task force, it is our action plan, and many of these things are in that action plan. It has not been completely approved by the task force yet. It is in a draft form. I will share it with you tonight with that caveat.
Many of what's in the action plan, I'm sorry.
The things that I'm going to talk about. Okay. Some of the things you've mentioned, and they're things that we have been working, you know, alongside doing since we started working in October and even before that. So we are planning an in-house diversity job fair for all job categories across all levels. The date is going to be April 27th, 4 p.m. in the Red Cafeteria at Brockton High School. We're drafting a flyer to colleges welcoming all teachers looking for diversity and committing to helping with licensure. Because another slide I'll show you this evening is when you talk about, and there are many people that come up to me and say to me, and these are, again, people, and I want them to come up to me, and I want them to say, I have a sister or brother, they would love to teach in Brockton, and many of the minority candidates. And what we're finding is we need to work through. Many times there is a question about the licensure, and let me give you an example. It could be somebody, again, that has graduated, with a bachelor's degree, but has not gone through and on there. There are some of the requirements for getting a preliminary license and an initial license. And if there are people out there that need to do that in order to qualify for teaching jobs, our HR office is willing to sit down to help them with the proper paperwork. Sometimes it's difficult to get through the bureaucracy of the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. And those of you that are educators know exactly what I'm talking about. So again, we're willing to work with people if that is something that is holding somebody back. Come to the job fair, and we'll continue to talk to you about those jobs. When you look at a job like a monitor teacher assistant, and this came up in our conversation with our diversity task force, there was pushback from community members saying, we don't want to talk about monitor teacher assistants. We want to talk about teachers. The thing about monitor teacher assistants is many times, again, it's an opportunity with a bachelor's degree to come in and to serve in a school. Now, you could very well have your teacher license at this point, and we don't have a job. But what happens is you start to work with a principal. You become part of that school. The principals are the hiring agents according to law, because the accountability lies with the principals. And that is in the Acts of 1993, the Ed Reform Act. It used to be the superintendent had all the hiring power. Now the principals hire at their level. If you're hiring for a school, the principals have that authority. So by being a monitor teacher assistant, you're working with the principal. When an opening comes up, the very first thing, and I've seen it happen time and time again, the principal will look to that person that is part of the school, has substituted in classes, working in a special needs class, has gone on to get their licensure. Those are the people getting hired. A monitor teacher assistant job is a good job, it's an entry job, and there are candidates that should be looking at that job. I believe those positions, there are a number of them many times. Also, we're working with paraprofessionals who come into the classroom and realize that this is an area that they would like to work in as a teacher. Right now, we're working with Baywood. I worked with Sheila Sullivan-Jarden, who actually had some grant money to assist people if they wanted to continue on in their education or try to pass some of the testing that needs to be passed in order to get into the workforce. We're looking to do outreach to multicultural media, like teachers of color, educators of color, as well as diversity job board and LinkedIn. I mentioned the paras and the MTAs. And the other thing that came up in our task force was making sure that we are working not only with our principals, but our administrators to talk about professional development and making sure we all understand, you know, what it is, and not just about diversity in hiring, but making sure we're getting the best possible candidate, understanding how important it is for us to look a few years from now and to truly say that we have made a difference in what our workforce looks like in the Brockton Public Schools.
Superintendent, you're giving an excellent presentation. Not to cut you off, but I know people are going to have questions and the commissioners have questions as well. Or is there a larger part that you want to do here as well?
I can show you, if you would like, some data, if you'd like to pull that up. I guess it's not going to go the whole screen, huh?
Yeah, is there any way to do the whole screen?
No. The gentleman has sent me a thing because of this.
Oh, okay. All right, fair enough.
Okay, I apologize. I will read and share some of the information I have. So could you go to the chart on BPS employees that looks like this?
Is everyone in the community able to see this? Is this a good? No.
Oh. I can. All right. I'm sorry. I can just share with you.
Okay. So we're looking at some full-time data.
Yeah, Michelle, could you go to the first slide, please? So that's not the one showing the one with the graph, the bar graph. Thank you.
Okay.
All right. So when you look at BPS employees, you see 2010 to 2012 and then to 2014.
Yeah.
You will see an increase in our total minority staff. So in 2014, We have 16.4%, that's 316 minority staff, and 12.3% was African American staff. You see the same one, I think it's the next bar graph down, which is the EEOC, Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. And you see some very similar numbers. Sometimes it's difficult as far as who's reporting, what they're reporting as, so there is a difference between the two slides. So I'm on to the next slide, Michelle. Thank you. And you'll see the increase going up from 2010 to 2012 to 2014. I think the next one is important because it talks about teachers. It's full, that FTE is called full-time equivalent. Yep. And the year is for 2014-15, that's the present data that we have. And if you look at differing communities, Brockton has, out of all our teaching staff, full-time equivalent teachers, 83.4% are white staff, that's correct. 16.6% is our total minority staff, and 10.6 is identified as African American staff. Now, if you look at places like New Bedford, we're doing better than New Bedford. If you look at Springfield, which is a much larger community than Brockton, we're also doing better. If you look at Worcester, which is, again, a larger community than Brockton, we're doing better. So while we have a lot of room for improvement, I just think that's worth noting that Brockton has made an effort. We'll continue to watch these numbers. The next slide, I think, is also important to see. And this is our, and I asked for a hiring summary from 2014 to 2017. And when you look at our certified staff, you can see all of the numbers. I don't think you want me to go through each one of them. No. If you look at the BEA, that is your certified staff members. No. You know, we certainly are making slow gains. It's an area that is of concern to us for many of the reasons I shared with you. If you look at monitor teacher assistants, I think we've made great gains there. If you look at custodians, I think you'll see gains there. If you look at paraprofessionals, you'll see large numbers there. If you look at our school police, the two hires that I just mentioned, we've had gains there. And we continue to try to make gains in the areas with our principals and our assistants, our associates. The last part of this, if you could go to the diversity action plan, and please remember this is a draft, and I know you want time to ask questions, but many of the things that I just outlined there, and this is the beginning work of a group that has met, will meet for their fifth time, I believe, February 21st. And not only is this the program components, they're measurable outcomes for us, they're action steps that we'll take, and we have people that are responsible, and we'll finish up by creating a timeline. And this is something we've had for, again, a couple of months, and we're continuing to work on it so that we can finalize it.
Thank you. Thank you. We can begin questions. Go ahead, Ed.
Superintendent, you mentioned that in 2015 you let go 45 teachers, in 2016 you let go 6 teachers. When you call these teachers back, what is the hiring practice to bring them back? Is it time served, or how do you make that decision on who to call?
It's a number of things. What we have is a seniority book, and through contract negotiations, when a person is hired, you also go on a list. And you don't get to choose your list. If you're a special education teacher and have other certifications, you have to make a determination. So you would be maybe a special education teacher on that list. If you're a school adjustment counselor, you go on that list. If you're an English teacher at the secondary level, as D is, that's the list that D goes on. So when we look to, unfortunately, and this is a really difficult practice in our HR office, it takes hours upon hours. They have to look across every list. We have to look at the number of students we have in the Brockton Public Schools. And the real struggle for Brockton, there are many communities demographically that are losing students. We are not losing students. So when you talk about a budget that's a $10 million deficit, and you can cut every other area, you can cut technology, you can cut materials and supplies, you can look at cutting busing by trying to bring back neighborhood schools. But the bottom line is 69% of your budget is in the form of teachers, and that is where you would be able to find the largest amount of money. So when you lay them off, you start at the bottom of the seniority list. So the last one in is the first one out. And there is not a separation for minority teachers, non-minority teachers. If you talk about bilingual teachers, if they're teaching in the bilingual department, they do have their own list. So again, it would still be by seniority. And that is not unusual in the teaching profession.
My question is more about the recruiting process, and I know that you mentioned a little bit about that, and I didn't have a chance to look too closely at what the Diversity Task Force is doing, but my question is more about, I know that you are reaching out to a lot of the local colleges and universities, the UMass Boston and the Bridgewater State and the Stonehill, but has the district ever looked at historically black colleges and universities, which of course is more kind of our southern universities, but those have a tremendous amount of minority students in education programs, and have we ever been able to reach out to those universities to recruit in that way?
Right. I'll be happy to answer that, but I know Elisa Martineau, who has been in our HR office, and I'm sure Dr. Moran would agree. I'd like her to answer because she has actually gone on these trips, and she'll actually, you know, talk to you.
Thank you. Good evening. Yes, we have been to historically black colleges in the South a few years back when the money was there for us to travel. We were unfortunately unsuccessful. We did have students that wanted to interview with Brockton, so we would sit down and have a one-to-one interview with those students. But there were a couple of things that they were looking for that we were not able to give them at the time. And like Kathy mentioned, the budget is a huge, thing for us. So they wanted contracts. We could not give them contracts right then and there. They also wanted to have the ability to have us to pay for them to move up here. So we could not do that. We could not provide them with that type of money. So that was an impediment there.
Time frame, Elisa.
Oh my, I'm really going back here. I would say probably about 10 years ago. Yeah, 2002. 2003. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's been a while.
Is there more? Thank you.
And let me also mention, when you talk about recruitment, one of the things that we have talked about, and I think this is something we also need to look at as a community, there was something called the Teacher Next Door program. At one point, people were looking not only to have teachers, but to have teachers that live in Brockton. I think that's important also, to be part of the neighborhood, part of the fabric of the community. And there was a certain rate on the house. We had many teachers. I think, Dr. Moran, you said you took advantage of that back then in buying your house. So there are people that we're looking to talk to the banks. Also, you know, we need support for our Grow Your Own program. What about support for bringing people on board when you talk about recruitment and some loan forgiveness? So in other words, you come and teach in our community. Who, you know, are we willing to put that in our budget? I would like to have that money in the budget that says, you know, 10 candidates, we bring them on board, and they should just be our own Brockton students. And with that, when I still talk about the large numbers of excellent minority candidates up at the high school, you should see those students coming on board to take advantage. Loan forgiveness should be something that many of our students would be interested in. And is that something that we do with the banks, that we do with our businesses? If they all believe in diversity of our teaching force in Brockton, then they need to come together as a community and help us out in those ways. There is loan forgiveness because we are an urban district. If you come and teach for a number of years, I sign them all the time. So there is some loan forgiveness. I think if you're, it used to be math, there was some real high needs areas, probably the math and the sciences.
Thank you, Superintendent. Questions?
May I just ask a favor from the audience? It really is distracting, and I apologize for Ms. Smith to be able to hear the questions. We hear a lot of echo on this end, so where you're whispering, we actually can hear your conversation. So please, just a bit of a help from you to not have too much side conversation. Thank you.
Dr. Smith, it's certainly a pleasure to see you again, talk to you again. We've heard about the MTA program and the PA program in the school system, and I have heard that we have difficulty finding people of color who are in school who desire to come out as teachers. Can you give me, what are the numbers, if you will,
concerning the number of MTAs that we have in the system and PAs that we have in the system, please.
Okay, so for everybody here again, MTA is monitor, teacher, assistant, and PA, you're talking about paraprofessionals.
Right.
You know, Dr. Moran, do you have those? I don't have the numbers off the top of my head.
Lisa knows better than I do.
Okay.
All right.
There's 103 monitor, teacher, assistants right now.
103? All right.
And there's a little over 400 paraprofessionals right now.
400. Yeah. All right. Another thing. During a prior meeting of the Diversity Commission with the ESOL program, let me ask you this. In the school system, what help does Brockton Public School give individuals in the MTA program for paying the $150 that it costs to take the test and or the $500 that it takes to take a course, a prep course? How much assistance does the Brockton Public School provide for those individuals?
We presently do not provide that type of support for the teacher test.
All right.
You know, that is something that individuals, you know, pay for on their own,
right,
set up their own appointments.
Mm-hmm.
We give them assistance in that we'll work with them on what they need to. Here's a for instance. If you're a monitor, teacher, assistant, or a paraprofessional in our district, one real struggle is, and nobody can give up their job. You know, people need their benefits. They need their job. So we try to work out, because many times you have to have hours in a classroom as part of a practicum.
Right.
So we are able to put them into classrooms, a special education classroom,
mm-hmm,
a classroom that they're in, depending on what their licensure is for, so that they can get those hours in while they're working cooperatively with the teacher in that classroom.
Right.
So that is support that we provide.
All right.
And again, I have been there when Elise Martineau and Dr. Moran have spoken to all our principals to make sure that they connect with HR, that we know who those individuals are,
right,
and we'll support them and make sure the correct things are in place for them.
Okay. Next part of that caused me some concern. We've had an opportunity for the ESOL department to be here with us, and according to the testimony of the ESOL program, I always had an opportunity to meet with them. And I do understand that should we understand that our purpose here tonight is not the sake of criticizing, but it is the sake of emphasizing, if you understand. I understand that the ESOL program, English as a Second Language program, I understand by the testimony that was given here, MTAs and PAs in the ESOL program, their fees are paid for them. My question then is, how is the ESOL program's fees are paid for their students and people of color's fees are not paid?
Right. So Reverend Downey, I'm not sure who came and spoke before you. So when you say ESOL program, are you talking our bilingual department in Brockton?
I am talking about Brockton's bilingual department. We had a...
Ms. Kelly?
Are you talking Kelly?
You're talking about Jones?
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, came
and,
before you.
Okay, yeah. So what I'm saying is we had, and I also had a meeting with them on the outside, and they confirmed. And once again, this is not an effort to jam some other students up, but my concern is, I think it's important to show the ESOL program that we are attempting to integrate individuals into the system. But the concern that I have is, how is that happening, and people of color from the United States are not able to get the kind of assistance that they're getting.
Reverend Downey, I don't have a clue about where money is coming.
That's what I was asking
from
too.
The bilingual department to pay for those fees. I would be happy. I'm not sure if there's a grant.
Yeah.
And that's something I will have to look into, because I'm not aware of that at all.
Okay. Can I just say one? Just one there.
You have about 50 seconds, sir. To
answer. All right. No, no, I don't need that.
Okay.
I'm just saying that I think that if we were to find a way to work together, whatever grant that they have in a city of Brockton enough, if we can find a way to get some money, I think it is important. Because what happens when this kind of thing happens, it's a possibility that African-American students can then get upset, aggravated, and frustrated because ESOL are getting something and they're not. That's the comment. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. Superintendent, I just have a couple of questions. And again, we want to make sure we get questions from the audience. So I just want to go back to, because our role as a commission is really to go back to our findings of fact with respect to our Brockton Public Schools. The first finding, we requested that all resumes and applications be tracked and the hiring decisions. We came to that conclusion because we had testimony from individuals that had applied for positions in Brockton Public Schools that were qualified, had the degree, and were certified. One case that was reminds me of stuff that used to happen in South Carolina is that they came to the school and was told that the position was already filled and the interview was canceled. It would seem to me, professionally speaking, that that person would have known that well in advance. So have you instituted a way of tracking the applications and the resumes per our request?
Well, when you talk about tracking the applications and the resumes, and when you talk about something like School Spring, it allows people from everywhere, not just Massachusetts. It could be somebody in Alaska. You know, and there are many people that if any of you have used School Spring, you put in your resume, your documents, and you can apply for any jobs. So I'm sure Dr. Moran will tell you, and I'm going to let her speak to this, there are sometimes you put a job ad out there, and you could have 250 applications for a particular job. We don't have the capacity in HR, and I'm not exaggerating, for some jobs. So I think we will work with you and try to figure out how we go through those resumes
and
figure out locally.
So I don't think anyone's looking for you to track all resumes, I mean, if you want to do that. But we are looking for you to track is those that you've made a hiring decision on. So if someone reports, because this clearly would have been a probable cause finding EEOC, somebody reports to an interview and they're told they're a person of color and they're told they're not, the position has already been filled, is very, very concerning. So that's what we're looking for.
Sure.
Does that make
sense?
And
if that happens, I would like to know that.
Sure. Yeah, okay.
As Kathy Smith said, one of the things about School Spring, for example, is where people automatically get a response once they submit their information.
Right.
I'm not aware of the situation that you're speaking of. As a former principal, you know, we do our utmost to invite people to interviews, and certainly when they show up, it would not be for a position that was already filled. So we, you know, we can definitely speak to the principals about things like that. I hope that was an isolated case that, you know, does not happen regularly. It's, you know, professionally not very beneficial for someone to show up with their resume and their suit and find out that the job is taken. We did have some ideas seeing that finding. We just very recently, I believe last week, we were able to put our application on the BPS website online, so you can complete it online. We always had the paper application. People have to print and hand it in or fax it in, and now you can complete it online. What we're going to do, it's going to an automatic system within the district into an email, and we can also have responses letting people know that they've been received. In addition, as we send out these resumes to principals, we can talk with them about, we need the information back. We need to know when you have 80 applications on School Spring and you've interviewed 40, we would like a spreadsheet back explaining who you interviewed, why the people were not selected. What often happens is when a principal has one opening but finds three good candidates, those principals pass the name of the other two along. Because there oftentimes is a lot of opening, there's a lot of people looking for very few openings. So that's that was a great suggestion that we thought we could definitely begin to implement in our office and do some tracking using the principals after they've done the interviews.
Will you be developing a metric for that? An example of that is, so I interview someone, mm-hmm. I decide not to hire them.
Mm-hmm.
That hiring decision, those interview notes, are they going to be, where are they going? Are you keeping that? Is that HR? Is the principal keeping that? How are you going to create a metrics
we
to
actually,
track this work?
Sure, we actually have a tracking sheet right now. So the principals complete an applicant, it's a form that they complete after the interview, and they submit those to Human Resources. We collect them, but we've never done any tracking of,
gotcha.
So we have them, we just haven't done what you've asked, which we think is a great suggestion to help us see if the same people are coming out and what's happening with the interview process.
Thank
but
you.
We do have that already, but thank you.
Thank you. And my other question is that, Superintendent, you mentioned that the issue, and I do remember, I've lived in Brockton for about 31 years, is that the issue of diversity has always been an issue, whether it's a municipality or whether it's a school department. But what concerns me is that when I hear principals, not principals in terms of principals of schools, but leaders come before commissions, they say that, well, this has been an ongoing problem. So I guess my question to you is, when you found out that it was a problem, did you build a metrics to determine that you've succeeded? So 13, you didn't hire people of color. 14, I didn't hire people of color. Did you build something into your system to correct that? And I guess the real question that leads me to ask, who's ultimately responsible for diversity in Brockton Public Schools? Who's ultimately responsible? Is it the superintendent? Is it Dr. Moran?
Yeah, well, I think it would have to be certainly the superintendent. You know, I'm ultimately responsible. I'm responsible for making sure that my human resource office is doing everything they can to follow up on recruiting when we have openings, to making sure people have a fair and open process to jobs that they're qualified for, and if in fact they're not, to make sure that we're providing opportunities, because we need to provide opportunities. You know, when you hear us talk about MTAs and paras or grow your own, you know, as I said, we can talk and talk about going far and wide to find people. Our best people are right here. And that's why you hear me talk about the kinds of candidates that we have.
And we agree with you, and I guess that's what alarmed us, hence the F rating. We agree, totally agree with you. What the folks that have come before us are not talking about my teenage son or daughter that's in high school. We're talking about mature adults that have applied for Brockton Public Schools, and for whatever reason, the resumes got lost, they weren't called. These are qualified applicants that are applying right now, and that's why we're actually here tonight. I get it. I get grow your own, and I get pipelines for the future. Mm-hmm. But what about those folks that are skilled today that want to apply or have applied, and for whatever reason they have not been hired?
And Bishop, how are we tracking? Well, we track all that data. I mean, I just can't. You know, I put up on the screen a hiring summary for 3 years. So I do have a hiring summary of people from every one of the areas, whether they were teachers, whether they were custodians, whether they were school police. We have to track this information. Right. So we track it for EEOC. We track it for the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. It's not a perfect science. People self-select what they are. Mm-hmm. So unfortunately, I can't say it's perfect, but we certainly have, you know, collected that information. And I do feel like we're making some progress. As I said, I wish I could tell you differently about a budget. It has been very difficult. When you had years of hiring 100 teachers at a new teacher orientation, we have not had a teacher orientation in, I think, 2 years. And when we had them previously, we didn't have those large numbers. I can only speak to since coming on board in 2013. When you hear me speak otherwise, I don't want to back away from it. I am a proud member of 40 years of the Brockton Public Schools. And I look at what those struggles certainly have been throughout the years. We can do better. I assure you, that is my goal. I'll come before you at any time. You can hold me accountable. If there are things that you would like us to put in place, we'll put them in place. If we can work with businesses, if we can work with minority communities, we're looking at our website, making sure that jobs are up there. Tonight I read off 10, 15 jobs. If there is anybody out there that has these licensures, these certifications, and you can fill these jobs, please connect with us right away. We'll work with you to qualify you or to find out what you need.
And were those per our recommendation, are the jobs that are posted, do they have the label minorities encouraged to apply?
I don't believe we have that. We do not discriminate. I believe we have the words, we do not discriminate on the basis of.
So are you willing to do that?
Bishop, I'm willing to do whatever. I just have to find out legally, is that something I can do?
I will
certainly work with my school committee. I will work with our legal counsel. We do not discriminate, and we welcome our minority applicants to apply.
So, just one other question. So we all know that the city of Brockton was just recently hit with a judgment. And I haven't asked you this, but I'm going to ask you this now. Are there pending EEOC complaints or Superior Court complaints going to trial with respect to discrimination within the Brockton Public School Department?
I don't know of any right now. No EEOC complaints.
No EEOC complaints, okay. And then the other thing, too, is are you willing to have, because you agree that this has been ongoing, we started introducing diversity officers 20 years ago. Pardon what I'm about to say, but I don't know how other to say this, with the whiteness of what's happening in the school system, why haven't we hired a chief diversity officer?
And it happened in Boston, too.
I have never known us to have a chief diversity officer. I think it sounds like a great idea. I would be very pleased to have another administrator, believe me, with everything we have on our plate, with all of the advocacy, with all of the things that all of you know we struggle with right now to make sure our children get the very best. And I've told you this is a priority. So if the city would like to give us a chief diversity officer, you know, that's gold to me. So as far as that, I have every confidence, and I want to make it clear to everybody, I have confidence in my human resource office. They have worked very hard. They have certainly been out there. They've been dealing with trying to encourage people to come into the profession. And I'm talking, again, all walks, not just teachers. That obviously is the business we're in. Right. So I want to be careful here. There isn't a day that Dr. Moran doesn't say to me, I have another staff member?
Right. And we don't, let me be clear for the public. We don't discount that. But I remain concerned, are your principals, the message that you give to the community, because you did this at Messiah, are the principals getting this message? The people that are making these hiring decisions, are they getting this message? You've done some recent work, that is true, the hiring of the black police officer, the assistant principal, I get all of that's very new work. But there has been something going, there has been a cancer in the system that has kept us from hiring minorities. So are the decision makers down the line buying what you're saying?
And you know what, Bishop, here's what I'm going to say to that also. I have a minority principal up at Brockton High School, the largest school east of the Mississippi. Let me finish. Yeah. I have a minority principal. I have a minority principal at East Middle School. I have a minority principal at South Middle School. I have a minority principal at the Angelo School. They are hiring along with all of the other principals. Are they getting the message? Well, I'll tell you a comment that was made, and this was made during a diversity task force meeting a month or so ago. Our principals are excited, and that doesn't matter if it's a minority principal, a white principal. When they can hire a minority candidate, they're excited to do that. So I will make sure. One of the things I started out by saying was there had been professional development. I know Dr. Moran, and this has come from our own task force. They asked those very same questions. So respectfully, we will do professional development, not just with principals who are our major hiring agents, but throughout the whole district, to make sure we're encouraging those administrative applicants from our very own, encouraging teachers to come on board, and that's why, again, I don't want to discount any of those areas. Deputy Superintendent Thomas is unable to be with me today, a kid that grew up here in Brockton. Many of you know him, and he has done an excellent job. He oversees the school police, the custodians, and again, we are really making inroads. I know it's not perfect. I want to continue to work with you, and when I leave here, and I will leave here at some point. It doesn't feel like that some days. But I do hope I can look at all of you and tell you that it has made a difference. So, you know, we will do the best we can and work with you.
Commissioner Taggart.
Thank you.
One, I do want to thank you for coming before us. We've had, you know, I've had the good fortune due to Commissioner Downey of being on the recruitment and retention committee with BIC and NAACP. So I have a few questions, and I do, and I have spoken to you about this. I'm getting time now. He does it. But again, we realize there's an issue. I appreciate that you come in before us, and you know, these conversations are going to be uncomfortable, but we have to make sure they're constructive and positive, because we need to be able to move forward. I did hear, and I was bothered by some of the complaints that I had heard from applicants of, you know, showing up for an interview, like Chairman Branch said, and, you know, being told that the position was filled, and just some other things. What is a way for applicants who have complaints? What is the process for anybody who does have a complaint? Because I honestly believe exactly what you're saying, that you're not being told about some of these instances. How would somebody report or complain if there was a issue with their hiring process?
You know, they certainly can reach out to the superintendent office. There isn't a phone call that I do not take. I am happy to speak to anybody if they feel they have not been treated fairly in an interview. I would immediately share that with Dr. Moran, who would investigate it.
So they should call
the human resource office, the executive director. If they need to call the superintendent's office, again, I speak to parents all the time. I take difficult phone calls, and I would certainly look into something, you know, that was amiss in your talking when somebody applies for a job.
Yes, yes.
And you and I spoke about the situation,
yes.
And I was aware of it, and it had been taken care of, and it was taken care of. It was very considered very serious.
I appreciate that. On the online application, and I know it had just been redone because you said earlier that it was paper applications. So I'm only smiling. Like, I can't believe we're still doing paper applications. But I went on the website, and I didn't see a spot or a box or somewhere where an applicant could self-identify. I mean, I guess that question, again, I just looked. So maybe I'm looking, so I can be wrong. I'm okay with being wrong. It's not that serious. But how do we?
We can't ask. They can identify.
Right. Well, but there should be on any application, and it should tell you that you don't have to. You don't have to identify yourself, but it's optional. But I mean, how would you track what applicants are applying? Earlier it was said.
We legally can't. I do not believe we can put that on the application.
With your human resource
background? Talking about the self, my colleagues in HR, the self-identify including veterans disability status. That's not there?
The application.
The application, that's all he's
saying. The one that's online?
No.
It's not on there. So what was said earlier, there was a way to, people, how would you?
No, I was saying, I had talked about school spring, and there are times people will tell you they speak two or three languages, so we were able to look at something like that. There are many times people will say there are some identifying factors in the resume themselves.
Because Commissioner Miller is, you look very ill. I'm so sorry. Thank you for coming out. Mm-hmm. Commissioner Miller has a question, and then Commissioner Cabral.
Again, thank you for coming down. You mentioned that the principals have the power of hiring.
For their schools. Correct.
Could you explain how, in quick detail, how the application process goes from when it's submitted to who it's submitted to and when it finally comes back to you?
The process is that, again, we have, we just mentioned online, we had paper applications for many years. So all of the qualifying information goes through human resources. People put their letter of intent, they put their recommendations, references. All of the things that are asked when you're applying for a particular job qualifies them through human resources. What Dr. Moran and her staff will do is when there is an opening, and you mentioned a principal, the principal will say, I have a third grade opening. That requires an elementary certification. Dr. Moran will go through all of, and many times by hand, all of the resumes that we had, putting them together. Principals will come in. They'll go through the pile of resumes. They'll start to select. It could be based on, you know, college experience, outside work that they've done. There's many factors a principal will look at. They will invite in many times, depending on, again, if they were hiring a large number of elementary teachers, you know, 10 candidates, and they will interview each one of those candidates, usually an opportunity along with another one of their leadership staff members. They will then make that recommendation to Dr. Moran in Human Resources, and it is approved by the superintendent. So the principal is the hiring agent, the superintendent has approval. If at any time the superintendent does not approve of a hire, and that's not my practice, if a principal and the person meets the qualifications, I approve that hire. And that goes before our school committee in our school committee agenda each one of our school committee meetings.
Thank you very much.
Commissioner Cabral. Then it'll be Commissioner Trask.
Good evening and thank you for coming before us. I'm going to try to summarize my questions. And I know that the topic today is employment, job retention, all that. And I listened to the presentation, beautiful presentation. But my question will go a little bit on a different direction, more in terms of education services delivery system, if I can call that. So, and when I say that, I'm thinking of the students. I understand that the opportunities for jobs are important, that be equal to the residents of Brockton, the diversity, whatever. But I'm thinking of the diversity in terms of the characteristics of our students, what they are receiving, how are they receiving, how are they being treated. And I understand that a lot of the times, being a minority teacher could be being a role model for the students, and that has a benefit in terms of students, you know, probably staying in school, not dropping out, all of those beautiful things. But what I'm thinking is, besides the job opportunity, what are some of the practices in terms of policies, in terms of programs, in terms of activities that will remediate the fact that what was presented here? Small minority teachers, small minority staff, what else are we doing to remediate this situation, for example? And I'm thinking of, for example, probably I may have to explain a little bit more, but what I'm thinking is students sometimes, and I'm gonna say this because I'm a mental health practitioner, so I see students every day, I go to school every day, and I interact with families, so I listen to families. So what I hear sometimes is that some students feel that they're not welcomed. It's their perception. It could be true, it could be just a perception. But I'm sure those factors affect how long that student will continue in that school, and whether it will be successful or not, or whether it will stay in school or drop out of the school. And I believe if you look at the data, the gap in education, you're probably gonna see that, even though I understand that the Brockton Public Schools has a very high success rate for all students, but if we look at the demographics, we probably will see that the minority students' dropout rate will increase drastically versus the other community. And I'm not placing blame to anything, but sometimes what people call systemic racism, and I know racism is a strong word, so I didn't want to use it, but I have to use it anyway. It doesn't have to be a conscious thing. It could be just an unconscious thing happening every day. People just doing common sense things, it still can be interpreted as racism. Another thing is, sometimes it could be just, it's just not doing something could also be interpreted as, you know, result as a discriminatory practice. So my assertion to this is that probably one way is that the public school teachers, administrators, create some types of policies, programs that will try to go against those things that could be unconscious. I'm not saying that people are doing things on purpose. So my question probably, just to go to the question, is what are some of the practice that goes to that?
Is it Commissioner Cabral? I'm sorry.
Yes.
So Commissioner Cabral, I could spend all night talking to you about what you have just asked me. So first of all, if I'm understanding what you're saying, and out of 1,400, so I'm going to talk about teachers. I'm going to talk about teachers who clearly are with students every day. Yeah, do you mind?
Sure.
I probably shouldn't have you sitting that close to me, huh?
Tomorrow I'm going to be sick now.
Yeah. So I'm going to start out by saying every year we're very fortunate to graduate almost 1,000 students from Brockton High School. And you heard me talk about, and these are students of every race, creed, color. They're getting accepted at prestigious colleges. They're going on to college, to career, to the military. Just look at our JROTC. I would say, again, 99% of the teaching staff in Brockton goes above and beyond to mentor kids, to make sure that they are in programs, in clubs, to spend time with them, to make sure that they succeed. We are an award-winning district, not just level one and level two, almost unheard of in a large urban district. But we also are a school that was given an award for being what they call, and certainly if you're in the field, you know when I talk about social and emotional learning. We have trauma-sensitive schools and have received awards for that. I've been spending time, because I'm presenting in Los Angeles very soon, about our district and what they do. I've gone to schools where school adjustment counselors have created calming rooms, teaching kids about meditation, how to be centered in themselves so that they can deal with some of the stressors, and kids are dealing with stressors. We have one of the largest homeless populations. Yes, they do. They receive professional development many times during our in-service presentations. You know, we certainly talk about it. At one point, Commissioner, when I first came on board and I was really excited about you come on and you know the district and there are things you want to move forward, one of the things I talked about was a cultural proficiency specialist. I actually had a teacher during an internship, Jariel Vernet, who has left the district and found a job in another district because it wasn't a position I could bring on. We have continually been cutting administrative positions, teaching positions. So unfortunately, when you're trying to grow some of those things, and maybe it's something that you're going to tell me I need to make a priority. And that's the message that the school committee gets, and that's the message. But I say that because I do believe our teaching staff goes above and beyond. They work with children in extended programs. There's coaching. I am pleased with how, for the most part, and that's not everybody. You know, there are conversations that, right now, one of the conversations that we're actually having is looking at our code of conduct. One of the things that's important is it has to be user-friendly. In other words, we have a very large high school, 4,300 students. There are consequences for behavior. These are young men and women growing up. We need to hold them accountable. The most important thing is that they graduate and go on to be successful, to be good citizens, and certainly good community members. But we're looking at ways to make sure that that is user-friendly so parents understand that you don't just get a handbook that comes home and you have to go through all the legal jargon, which we have to have in there because of policy, but also to make sure...
Sorry, not to interrupt, just to fill in so we can continue. So when I say those things, and the example that I can point is, for example, I spoke with a student who told me that she was punished, this is a drastic code, and I'm thinking culturally, because sometimes that has to do with the cultural differences. No. The dressing code is one part applied to black students, I'm just reporting whatever I heard. And another code is for white students. And the reason that she explained is that, for example, certain dress code is appropriate because of the body type for certain groups of students and not. And I'm going to say this is from Brockton High School. So, and I'm not trying to point fingers, it's just that if this is the kind of things that happens, it seems to me that this is discriminatory practice.
Well, I would need that. I would need that brought to my attention if that's what is happening.
Just something that may not be true, and I hope.
Now, if somebody brought that to my attention, I would certainly look into it. And maybe what the answer is to that, and I had the opportunity to visit another district, and it was a district much larger than Brockton, and they had uniforms for all students. Amen. So would we like to commit to uniforms for all students? I'd be happy to bring that to the school committee. It's been very successful with our younger children. I think by law, we're not able to do that with our high school students, but it could be something that we certainly look at. And believe me, I think the teachers would applaud you for mentioning a dress code that's the acceptable.
The last piece is the discipline. This is, I'm just speaking in terms of cultural perception, the assumptions that we can make, I can make wrong assumptions too. So what I'm, the other thing that I want to refer has to do with the discipline practice. And when I say that, and I'm thinking of low-income communities, people who doesn't speak a language, and so sometimes are not all aware of the school policies, or probably the home is devastated with poverty, problems, all kinds. Some of those students come into the school with probably different types of behavior, and sometimes they're seen as less, maybe not work with, that's the perception, and I'm not blaming. A lot of the students tell me, a lot of the parents tell me, and a lot of the times they drop out of the school because of that.
Yeah.
I understand people may be trying, and this is what I said. Sometimes people do things unconsciously by just doing the common sense things. But then my thing, I know the time is up, is that maybe the training should address those specific factors and accountabilities also exist. So, and I agree with the idea of diversity officer, for example. That would be a role of diversity officer.
Thank you. Time of the gentleman has expired. Janice
Sorry
Trask.
For taking this long time.
Yeah, that's fine. Commissioner Trask. And after Commissioner Trask, we need to go to the audience. Absolutely.
Thank you, Superintendent, for being here. And first of all, I'm going to make a statement more than ask questions. As a proud member of this Brockton Diversity Commission, I would like to acknowledge that I believe white privilege is a very real thing. I think many of us as white parents in Brockton have not realized fully how much we and our children have benefited from white privilege. As we saw our city and schools becoming more diverse, I feel we should have been more keenly aware and cognizant of these changes in order to ensure that all the children in our community have an equal playing field. That equal playing field includes allowing all our children the benefit of seeing city workers, especially their teachers and other school staff, that more fairly reflect their skin color and cultures. This opportunity helps our students to more clearly understand that they too can be successful in whatever professions they choose. Going forward, we know Brockton has a great school system, and we are all very proud of it. However, we can do better. We as a city need to be more thoughtful, more mindful, and more deliberate in our hiring practices and process, especially in our schools. We're all responsible to provide our children with the best school system possible. This means we must work harder at increasing diversity amongst our school staff at all levels. This sometimes means challenging the status quo, which is tough, to ensure equal opportunities for all children in Brockton. We need to do a better job at creating more inclusiveness by better celebrating and embracing our rich diversity in this great city for the sake of our children. Thank you.
We should go in order. Bishop Texera.
Yes, thank you.
1 minute, you all. Please, let's keep it to 1 minute.
No.
Go ahead.
I'm going to sit down.
We want to be able to get everybody if we can.
It takes a white privilege to speak the reality of Brockton. Shame on you guys, black and brown people in this table. You are supposed to speak on our behalf, and you didn't. It takes discouraged women to speak for us the issues of Brockton. Go read what ex-police officer Ken Williams is doing right now at the federal court. And Bishop Texera is that. You know, there's so many people here behind me and the other side who knew this issue for years. That's why challenging her is not about 10 years ago. It could be even like 15, 20 years ago. 30. I was the board member of Champion Charter School, and white privilege kicked me out because I spoke the truth about our children. And all this commission here love you as a child of God, but you do not speak on our behalf because you don't walk the walk we do every day with young people at Brockton High School. And Superintendent, I finally got some respect for her, but it was a hard way to do it. So let us not be lying to each other. Let us be honest to each other. Brockton has the issue of discrimination in this building where we stand, in all its corner. No, don't tell me thank you, because I've been here for many years and nobody's listened. Because there is so many dollars we're losing, now you need to listen if you want to do the job. Because I'm speaking on the thousands of people who are not here that don't speak the language that you and I, Maria, speak. So give me one more minute, because I deserve, because all those questions you ask, it's a ponytail. Yes, I do. I know. And I can tell many people give me their 1 minute. If I ask, they'll give it to me. Because I've been speaking the truth for many years. And it's not to laugh.
Bishop, go ahead. But yes. You do realize what we did say. That yeah. I personally said there was discrimination.
Yes. Yes.
And
finally, I respect you, brother. I respect all of you. But the truth needs to be told.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. Let me finish. Okay, because you took me all my 15 minutes away. But anyway,
Bishop,
okay, 1 second. Superintendent, your task force, the people you have in your school, are not going to help you. You need to look at the new face of Brockton. The new people are not being yet corrupted by the politics and politics of Brockton. Because the people you have behind you, you know the name I'm going to use, you might be mad at me. They're all house slaves in Brockton. They're not speaking for our children. They're using our children for their own benefit, their own interest. So if you want to deliver what you told this commission, go find new blood. There's a lot of young people here who've been challenging you for years, 2-3 years. These are the, because they're honest, they come honesty. Those people around you that you mentioned, I can put my hand in the Bible. They're going to make you fail because they'll be honest with you. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Bishop.
Kelly Hamlin.
Not speaking. Jaquel Yarrell, excuse me.
No.
Left?
Isn't
that you? Dee Dee Bell. Maria Perez. Hilda Yerger. Inez,
she left.
Estella, Tracy Garn, Isabel Lopez, Sharon Little. Come on, Sharon, come on up here now.
Superintendent, I called you. In 2012, I called you. My daughter, her dream school was to go to UMass Dartmouth. She went to Champion School and didn't know anything about the Gateway to College program. I called you. I wrote the dean. I wrote the assistant dean. I put it in writing. You never heard of Sharon Little?
In 2012, I was not the superintendent. I came on in July 13. Yeah. I'm not sure.
Okay, well, I'm sorry. Maybe 2013. I thought you were superintendent. Sharon Little. I wrote you a letter. I've been wanting to get in front of you for years, for the last couple of years. You were superintendent, and you need I don't know why the Champion Charter School didn't know about the Gateway to College program. This was under your watch. The school, they knew nothing about it. Nothing.
First of all, it's Champion High School and at the Keats Center, and we do have, as a matter of fact, it is Gateway is part of that program. So look, I don't remember the conversation, and I'll be glad to look into it with you. So I'm not sure I can address that.
And maybe. I mean, because I called you several times. I called you, and they even got aggravated with me, you know. Calm down. This is my child.
How can I help you now?
Nothing. I just wanted to say that I called you. And another thing is that, how did you feel about the casino?
Did you want me to answer that?
Yeah.
Okay. Can I have the microphone, please?
I took a very controversial stand, and the reason I took a controversial stand is that I felt at the time, looking at the budget ahead for our Brockton students, who within 1 year are going to have to pass the high-stakes testing on computers, and looking at our budget, looking at the laying off of teachers and staff, and listening to what I listened to with the commission to bring the casino forward, looking at jobs for our students' families, looking at the poverty. Yes, I did take a controversial stand, and I did support the casino coming to Brockton at the time.
I don't think you care about our children, that you wanted to put a casino in our backyard. And I just wanted to say to you guys, like, Brockton's being run like a plantation. This, you know, separating the Cape Verdeans and the Haitians and making them the new house niggers. And when growing up in Brockton, we all went to one facility. We played in the same place. We all stood together, black, white, Haitian, Cape Verdean. We were all one children. Brockton has always been the international melting pot. You guys got to stop being don't be Connie and Lawton's patsies and sell us out. If you're going to be the diversity commission, stand up for us. Help us fight. I've been here my my whole life. I'm not running down south. I don't want to run. I love my city. I'm a champion. Amen. I'm staying here. And you guys, being the diversity community, need to fight with us. Don't just benefit for your own family. Fight with us.
So just want to make sure everybody knows. So the Diversity Commission, Sharon, the Diversity Commission, as you know, we are all volunteers. And we are committed to the residents. But residents have to participate in the process. You all have to, let me be really, really clear on this. We're going to talk like we're in my living room. You all need to show up to the city council meetings because you're not showing up. You're not showing up to the school committee meetings. You're not showing up. You know, I know because I'm there. We have to be a community that's going to participate. The problem with black folks is self-apartheid. We're doing it to ourselves. We're not coming out and voting, and you're complaining that they're in control. This year is an election year. Participate. Participate. Seriously. You did say that.
I've been chasing down these meetings because I've been trying to get in front of this woman for years. I work.
I got you. And
these meetings can't just be on the city hall website.
Right.
You got to put them on Facebook.
You're absolutely right. But what I want you're absolutely right, Shan. You know, we've been rolling a long time. The point of the matter is that you have to participate. And it frustrates me that people not, I can't say, yeah, exactly. We cannot do this alone. We cannot. Anybody feels that these commissioners can do it alone, you're in the wrong place. It cannot happen alone.
Well, celebrate
the people that are here. Laurie, amen. Laurie Watson, please.
Hello.
All right.
It's going to be very quick.
That's okay.
But first of all, having been the only black woman in 140 students, I am taking offense to the fact that y'all want to relate this to house Negroes and plantation mentality, because I'll tell you right now, I didn't graduate 1/10 behind cum laude because I had a person that looked like me in class. What I want to know is what one thing that you all have forgotten to mention all night, merit. Because we have teachers, and trust me on this, having been through the family that I've been through and being in the Department of Education
Explain
for as long. Merit is how you keep your job. So if your numbers are down, you should not have a place where a teacher that can get in touch with our students should be sitting. But they keep being moved back in. Why? Because it makes the picture look nice? Because I'll be the first person to say, if I had a child and I had all summa cum laude teachers that knew that went in for professional development every chance they get, that did not have summers, did not have vacations because they were out there working for the kids. I don't care what anybody says, I'm putting my child and my friend's children in that classroom because the numbers matter. And that's why I have a problem with identifying on the applications, because it's equal opportunity. I want the credits in there, not the color. And as much as my people might not like me for saying this, you need to understand something. Equal opportunity means they don't see the color. You're allowing them to see the color when you act like this.
Thank you.
Thank you, Laurie.
Thank you so much, Laurie.
Marlene Amedee.
Oh, I'm done.
You're done?
Yeah.
Thank you. Ozzie Jordan. I was just signing that to say I was here, not to speak. Want me to say a few words? I was on the original Diversity Commission. I think I was dead for about 10 years or so. It was a little different than this. Our basic piece was we had a little mass commission against discrimination. That's what we were doing. We chased these kinds of things. We had people come before us. We had hearings actually here where we had individuals that came in with complaints. So they didn't have to go to downtown Boston or other places. We would then forward that to MCAD, and they would pick it up and run from there. That's one of the things that we did. All these things I'm hearing, and I've been around before, I think all of you, with maybe one exception, okay, in this room, doing this stuff, okay? It's the same thing. And I'm talking 40 years worth, all right? The same thing over and over. Part of this, you got to learn what's going on the other side, too. And I'm not making any defense for them. But all these systems, civil service, you've got to qualify. There's laws, there's regulations. You can't walk in, as your president will find out, and say, bye. Because half of these people are going to end up back there again.
Mr. Wolf's qualified.
okay? Yeah, he didn't get hired. He went through the system, and what's happening? But the system allowed him to do that. That was the system. But that's my point. You've got to learn both sides. You can't just say hire people. You've got to understand what that process is. HR qualifies. Then it goes to the principal, okay? And the superintendent and school committee have the final, if need be. You have places you can go to right now. Go to your local school committee person from your district. Talk to them. They also bring a complaint through. There's things that you can do, all right? This is great, but you got to know what your basic rules are when you're dealing with anything. You can't just shoot from the hip because you're not going to win. All right, and I can tell you how many things I've won around the city.
Thank you very much, Oz. I'm keeping with the list. Bradley. Mike, did you?
How's everyone doing?
Great.
How you doing, Ms. Superintendent? So I've been working alongside John Williams at Champion City. I've also been, you know, I've been grateful to be within the school system now and like see from both sides. Cause you know, when I was a senior, I was fighting against the system, the demerit system to be exact. Well, I feel as if what I want to say is that it's very important that the students of color within the school have teachers that reflect their culture. You know, in psychology in school, what I'm learning is that people are more prone and more comfortable learning and speaking to people who understand is from the same culture as them. That should apply within our school system too. I see the numbers, and I see that, you know, we're working, we're trying, but we need to work harder. You know, by 2020, we should have a lot more teachers of color teaching our students. And it's nothing against the white teachers, nothing against them. It's just that it's not the most effective way to teach our students. You know, and that is all that I would like to say today. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
First of all, Bradley, I've always been very proud of you. You are a proud graduate of Brockton High School. Bradley and I have had sometimes some difficult conversation. I'm more proud than ever of you now because, again, it's good to hear that you're working with certainly students that truly need your assistance. You know, you were certainly successful, and some of the students you're working with are not on that same track. And I know you've been doing some really good work in the schools working with the principal and, as you mentioned, John Williams and our mentors. I also want to say Bradley, so Bradley is the perfect example. So you look at Bradley, is he going to go into education? Is he going to come back to the district? Because he's absolutely correct that every bit of research out there, and it isn't anything about against a white teacher, but kids truly relate better, whether it's culturally, people that understand them, people that look like them, and for a lot of reasons, there is research out there saying those very things. So that's my commitment to you. And then the other part of that is, again, are you looking to go into education?
What I'll say to that is that I'm more so looking into being a community leader. But aside from that,
you already are, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
I
would say that when it comes to the teachers, I feel as if teachers need to, you know, give the students some motivation to become teachers because that was the last thing that I was thinking about when I was in school. Matter of fact, I couldn't really stand the teachers, you know, to be honest. So I feel as if we have to do a better job in getting to the students' minds that they can become teachers too, and here's why. You know, teachers should educate the students.
And Bradley, one of the things I started out by saying when I addressed 1,400 teachers on opening day, and Dee, you'll back me up on this, that was a conversation I had with the teachers. We need to do a better job. And part of that is creating, and we have created some Educator Rising, Future Teacher Clubs, and we're working really hard to get kids in there so that eventually, and it will be down the road, you will have teachers that look like our students in Brockton.
Thank you, Superintendent.
One solution. Let's have the community.
Pass the mic down right there.
One solution. Let's have the community meet the teachers. Let's have that. Let's have a community teacher slash something where we could bring create the platform for the parents to meet the teachers. Not just a parent-teacher conference where maybe it's an event where we do a basketball game or we do something, but we bring out the community and we bring out the teachers and they meet, you know, and build. That's building community, in my opinion, you know.
Thank you, Bradley.
My name is Ben Cowart.
Ben.
Oh, I'm sorry.
had a situation in 2012 where my son was wrongfully accused. And I think you guys had something in Brockton High where I told you guys, no one reached out to me, and my son is still suffering from those issues in 2013. The principal violated civil rights. Your handbook says the due process hearing before expulsion. He was suspended for, he missed 18 days of school without a due process hearing. And that's a clear violation of you guys' code. He had witnesses from teachers and students who said he didn't do what the principal said he did. And a police report backed up the principal without investigating. They just railroaded him. I want to give you this and my numbers on it.
That's really an offline conversation.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So why don't you give her your information?
Yeah.
Yeah, Ben, why don't you do that now?
Yep.
This superintendent, is that okay?
That's fine.
Yep. I have copies. You can go through it, and if you feel something can be done, you can call me.
Expelled.
I just wish somebody would say something to me so I could tell my son.
I'll be very happy to meet with you, and I do want to say one thing here. And many of you, if you drive by Central Administration, my car is there Saturdays, if there are Sundays, if there are nights, I never have not met with a parent, ever. I make phone calls, I sit there, I've had difficult conversations with a number of you sitting out there. I'll continue to do that.
Thank you.
So I do want to clear that up,
right,
that there is not a person that I have not met with. And I think it's important for the superintendent to be available.
Totally appreciate it, but just we're here for recruitment and labor statistics and stuff like that, so I would appreciate. These sort of disciplinary conversations really should be had offline.
My daughter can reflect on that.
Okay. Did she apply for a job?
Yeah.
Yes. Hi. Yes, I applied for multiple jobs at the Brockton School Department. Oh, sorry. I applied for multiple jobs, including Natara Wallace, paraprofessional, kindergarten, one-on-one paraprofessional. I went to job interviews, and they said that I was overqualified and that I would be here.
You were overqualified?
Yes, because I had an associate's degree and I had over 3 years of experience in childcare. And then I got a call saying that, you would have the job for a paraprofessional. Then I completely got another call saying, there's another job opening. That one got filled. And then I got another, they told me that you can go apply for another job, but I would have to wait till the job opening would be open. So I'd have to wait 2 or 3 weeks.
Theme. So
yes.
That's a common theme that we've heard over the last couple of months. So
right.
My suggestion would be, with the permission of the superintendent, is that your resume somehow get to Dr. Moran, and you guys figure out what's occurring with your,
okay,
with your opportunity. Does that make sense? Dr. Moran, is that rude?
I'm just kidding.
Sorry.
I just want to know how would that process be?
Right. And
ended.
That's what we're trying to figure out.
Because I don't want to keep getting promised jobs, and then they tell me that I have the qualifications, Burke recommend me to another school, and I keep jumping back and forth, going back to school department, walking there, because I don't drive.
You're right. So in employment, and especially in discrimination cases, you need testers, you need applicants. So you're a prime example of what the school department should look at. How did that happen to you? That's why I'm saying
okay. You
should talk to Dr. Moran, because she's ultimately responsible for something like that.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
Thank you. I might be out of order, but would you please ask the young lady to document with this commission name, address, and number, and things, so that we can have something to deal with?
We have that information here.
You have it there?
All
right.
Thank you, Commissioner.
We're being recorded. Mike, and I'm assuming you guys, we're pressed for time. We've got to get out of the room. Mike, did you have something to add to this?
We're at quarter of, and we will want to be thoughtful of everyone's schedule, including Dr. Smith. So we really need to be watching. I'll be keeping time.
Mike,
sorry.
Okay.
How you doing? My name is Mike Dockery. Some people know me, some people don't. But anyways, talk about a diversity issue where the ratio to teachers to students where is 90% I guess Caucasian that teach minorities. But anyways, long story short, a few years ago my son had an issue in the school system, and the way I approached the school administration, the ego and the cockiness that they had as far as explaining their actions didn't make any sense. What I found out from my son signed a petition around that the teachers, one particular teacher, DuPont, was violating the kids' civil rights without proper due process. 130 students signed a petition within, I think, 3 hours. This person, DuPont, still have a job. They put my son in the court system. They had a video with her for 8 months. Ms. Smith, I met with you, and I met with Minicello. And also, Mr. Minicello's an attorney. He quoted in the Brockton Enterprise that the school police, he didn't see the video, but he knew the cops did a good job of what they did. So him as an attorney to me makes no sense. But the fact that that teachers are allowed to practice racial discrimination and punish minority kids while letting white kids go when they do unpunished, that's not right. And the fact that you're here and being a good orator and talking and giving the same stump speeches you go around and telling people is falling for it, that's not right. And for the guy back there that says, yeah, something got to follow process and procedures, I've done all that. I've got more response from the federal government, from the Board of Education in D.C. and in Boston than I do from you guys, all you guys. And in fact, I tried to make a video about the Brockton school system, and a lot of people backed out. People who sit behind closed door and complain, say, yeah, but dealing with the same issues since I was a kid, scared to get on a video. And to me, that's like, it's hypocritical. You're part of the problem. And I think I mentioned to you in a school committee meeting, you're sitting giving the same stump. Well, not you, this guy. He's talking that game like I've...
Mike, do you have a question?
So basically, okay, federal law states that everyone's entitled to education free discrimination. Why this guy, DuPont, and other teachers that violate kids' civil rights still have a job? And what can be done to change that?
I don't know if you want to comment on this.
Yeah. Thank you.
Ollie, after Ollie, we're done.
I heard him bypassing his minute earlier.
How do you know
you bypassed his minute? He bypassed his minute, I thought.
Well, he's passing the microphone. We have 7 minutes.
Okay.
Ollie, you coming?
Mr. Jordan.
Yeah. Thank you. Oh, sorry.
Thank you very much, sir. I'll try. Superintendent, thank you very much for coming. And I know you love Brockton as much as I love Brockton. And I think what we have to talk about, what's important is how can we really track these applications? If a person's name is Derek Smith, how do you know he's black, Spanish, Puerto Rican? So I think it's important if you put that option on the application, which you can't, because every job application, you can put that on there. If they're black, white, look into it, and I'm pretty sure you can. And then that's how we know. And then we could track the record. We could say, okay, this person is black, that's hiring, that's looking for a job, and we have records that way, and it's with the application. And then if the person, optional, yeah. That's
optional.
And
you can do it.
It absolutely can. And what happens is that person doesn't get hired. Now we have a track record. It's in the file, and we could go back and we could say, okay, this person was black because we know they're black if they check it off, or Spanish or whatever. And that's accountability. That's how you hold accountability. And I know that you're going to do everything in your power to change the ship and make sure that we're all represented from the top to the bottom. Thank you very much.
I have one personal privilege because you did point out to me, and I apologize for that. Can you pass her the microphone? Where's the microphone?
I actually don't need a microphone.
Well, there you go. Because
I'm actually used to speaking very clearly.
My name is Miranda Fonce Johnson. I am an immigrant. I came here in 1973.
I'm a Brockton High graduate from class of 83, and I went to Cambridge College. I just moved back 14 years ago, and I just bought a house about a year ago.
Here in Brockton?
Here in Brockton.
Thank you.
I moved back, and I have my two daughters. Both of my daughters have gone through the school system. One of my daughters has ADHD, which I had to work very closely with school administrators, and I can tell you right now, I am not a pleasant parent when I'm not happy with the education that my child's got, or they're not getting what they need in the schools. Ms. Moran can actually speak to that, because she was at the Huntington, one of them. My youngest is at the high school right now. She hates school, absolutely hates school, because she doesn't feel like there's nothing there. And me, I loved school. My degree is a master's in management, and it's in organizational psychology with diversity. And at my job, one of the things that I do, because I'm part of a team, I'm a senior AP specialist, I work with my department senior director to do the interviewing for their department to make sure that, one, it matches, and that everyone fits, and the skill sets. Sometimes the education can be wavered for the skill. Because we have hired people, they didn't have the education, but they had the skill set or the aptitude to get the job done. I work for Bright Horizons Family Solutions. So I work in their corporate office. I work in Watertown, by the way. Live in Brockton, a little far, okay? But I'm here today. This is my first time coming to one of these meetings, but I go to every parent-teachers meetings that I can make it to. I used to be able to do it more often. However, time is not permitting when you work until 6 o'clock in Watertown. I believe in our school system. I believe in our students. I've spoken to Bradley, and there's a few others that I've spoken to here. But I will tell you right now, as somebody that actually volunteers with Sabuda, which is a camp that I am a volunteer with, if the individuals that are volunteering within the schools, if they're not speaking up for the students or going up to them and says, you know what, I understand that this is cool to wear your pants down, but let me tell you what it's like to be in the workforce. So educate when you are interacting with your students or with your child. Think of them as your customer and that you are the teacher. Stop putting all of the lessons that need to be done for our school system. I am so tired of people that come into the workforce from the high schools on up that no one, yes, I'm going to wrap it up, that no one told me what it was like to go for an interview. No one has shown me. These are things that I learned at the high school. How to interview. Where are those fundamentals that we are losing because of a test? Because we are teaching to the test, and no one can tell me different. No one can tell me different, because I see the stress of my children. I'm stressed. I get the phone calls. So let's be clear. There are fundamental missing items in our school systems that are affecting future generations starting now, if not 10 years ago. And I've been back in Brockton 14 years, and there hasn't been much of a change.
Well, we want to thank Superintendent Kathleen Smith for coming here today. Let's give her a hand clap. I know that it must have been difficult, and we are not, at least in terms of the work that we're doing, we're not looking to point fingers, but what we are looking for is transparency in hiring. And for those of you who are not aware, is that our next step after we complete this process with Brockton Public Schools, we're moving on to Brockton City Hall, the municipality, because we know that there are some significant issues. What people do not realize, these judgments are not covered by insurance. if in fact there's a $38.4 million or $4.5 million judgment against the municipality, it is the taxpayers that are going to foot the bill. So discrimination is costly. And I've said this, I said it to him, it is very, very costly. But on the same token, we must be responsible in making sure that we report things as they happen. It's interesting enough that Ozzie had mentioned one of the things they used to do in the past is that MCAD and EOC, they had a sort of walking, they would come to your districts, they would come to communities to hear, to have hearings and to file complaints. All of this now is done in Brockton and Springfield, but we actually don't want EEOC and MCAD complaints because as citizens, again, it's who's it going to cost? Us. So what we're trying to do is to make sure that the municipality and the school department has transparency. I want to thank you all for coming this evening. The Brockton Diversity Commission is adjourned.